everybody, and welcome back to Tony Northeastern. And I hope you're all keeping safe and well. And here we are, we're back at the bench, and yep, there's not a canopy in sight. We're having a little break from that this week, and we're just going to do a tour of the layout, a walking, talking tour, rather than just driving a train around the layout and stopping off at various places. We're just going to have a walk and talk tour of the layout. So in the meantime, I am preparing this loco, the first loco of 2023. You did see a Northeastern NS1 a couple of weeks ago, but that came late November, and it took us that long to get it on the layout. So here, so here we are. We have a Great Central D11 Zeebrugger. This is the first Great Central locomotive to appear on the layout. I think I've made a good choice here. This is a Backman, and come fully fitted with sound, so it's just a case of running it in once I've done all the oil points, just doing all the axle boxes and connecting rod joints, anywhere where there's going to be a lot of movement, even inside there on the pony truck. So yeah, so that is just about ready. I've added some of the details as well that comes in the detailing pack, and I've also got some little figures which I'll glue into the cab as well. So let's get on with the tour. Before we do the tour, I just thought I'd show you the loft as it is at the moment. From where I'm standing all the way over to the back wall is roughly 6.5 meters in depth, and so this is what it looks like as we come up into the loft. And over there in the far right is Newcastle Central, and then we have South Shields in the middle of the loft. And then down to the left, we have Tyne Dock. And I can just make out the Saracen's Head pub. So we'll just do a complete circle as we go around. So there's St Helder's Colliery, High Shield Station, and Little Haven Station, and as we come round, you can see parts that hasn't been touched yet, and it's a little bit messy over there, so I do apologize for that, but at least you can actually see the full room, as it were. There we are, back to the beginning. So where do we start on this tour? Right at the very beginning, over there at Newcastle. For those of you who are new to the channel, this is Newcastle's Grand Central Station. And the building in front of you is a Fallabon kit. It's a great looking kit. I've had to do very little in the way of modifying it to make it look like it was built in England, if you know what I mean. So I got rid of a load of stove pipes and made extra chimney breasts. And quite pleasing to the eye. And So we're starting at Newcastle because this was the first station to have some platforms made. Nice straightforward platforms, nice and straight, and they're 1400 millimeters long, so just enough to quite comfortably take a 6-coach train plus a loco. Now, although the station is reasonably good, I am not happy with it. It never got finished in my mind, and it's something that I will come back and look at, and there'll be a total revamp. That's for sure. The pico oval roof, that will disappear. I'll get rid of that, and I'll probably end up making a roof just to suit this station. But yeah, that's sometime in the future. But yes, in the early days of building this layout, I do like what most model railway enthusiasts do. They buy and plonk on the layout. And over the last few years, with all the scratch building and learning from it, I've got better at it, as you do. And I think I can transform this into something a little bit more northeastern. But there we go. This is Newcastle. It has 4 main huge platforms all right away across. It's more of a holding area, basically, because I've got no major sidings on this layout except for the storage roads underneath South Shields, which we'll have a look at in a minute. Anyway, this is Newcastle. The back scene, the Pico back scenes are beginning to fade, as you can see. They're beginning to fade. So when I come back to Newcastle, I'll probably be changing that out. There's Newcastle Junction South. Track work I'm happy with. There will be small changes over there. It's only because I bought that Northeastern ES1 over there. So that goods yard will now become a holding yard for all the coal wagons. And the goods yard will be moved over to this side, which we'll go into more detail when we get round to starting that. So yeah, this is Newcastle. And here is the Newcastle city centre, or my representation of it. I'm quite happy with the way that's turned out. 3D buildings, half relief, look quite good. But I will be changing out some of these buildings. Mainly, I might be getting rid of them three and putting in some Kingsway low relief buildings, because I think they'll look far better. And I will carry that on all the way down there. But I do like that modern image of concrete, so I might repaint that, give it a brighter look, because it looks like all those pico back scenes are fading, because let's face it, they're 7 years old now. So there you go, that's Newcastle, the city centre. As we move around, this is one of the first bridges ever built on the layout. It's road bridge, and it's got the street lamps on it. So that is the first bridge. I think I'll call it New Street Bridge, actually. To get some signs and start naming some of these streets. You notice how this Pico scene, back scene, has stayed nice and fresh. Hasn't faded at all. If we look closer, we've got the Wilbury Castle pub on the corner. Not a castle in sight though. Yeah, so this back scene down here, that stayed nice and fresh as the day that it was put up. Because that was revamped. I don't know if you guys remember me actually doing that. Had some, I can't remember what scenes was there, but they faded. And what I've done in between these back scenes is painted in these hillsides and the road going round. And that stayed fresh, hasn't faded at all. That signal box, Backman's signal box. Yeah, the prices of those have gone through the roof now. I remember buying that and it was just under 50 quid, I think it was, but now it's a lot more. So here we have the Newcastle MPD, Motive Power Depot. Absolutely crammed with logos. I've just got nowhere to park them. When I designed and built this MPD, I only had about 5 or 6 logos, and planning for the future, I didn't plan it to be big enough. So there you go. That's the thing about model railways, you just end up collecting and collecting. But I'm not a very big collector. And here we have the Backman engine shed with lights. I added them lights. It's got lights on the inside as well. That's better. We can actually see what's going on inside the shed. There's not a lot going on inside the shed at the moment. Very little detail was ever put into the shed. Just a ladder and a barrel by the looks of it. There we have a hose pipe and a tap. The hose pipe was made out of a little bit of soldering wire wrapped around a drill bit, 6mm drill bit. And as we turn around, we can see more of the locos that are in the MPD. There we have the Nighthawk A3 class. Quite famous on this layout, with the train spotting stories. And then we have the W1, the Enterprise, yeah, there is still more work to do with the MPD. It needs expanding just a little bit if I can. As you can see, there's not a lot of room on there to do anything really. There is some rails that are going to come off here, possibly either to create another siding or to join up with the Tyne Dock Junction here. What I could do, I could put a right-hand turnout in there, which would then, any locos are going to go straight into the MPD area, which would be great for the South Shields area, because any locos can just come up and then straight into here. Yes, here we have the brewery. I made a start on it and then I stopped. I've already done the track work once, and it's all got to be lifted up again. If I raise the camera, you can see why. There's 4 sidings, but there's no passing loop. I need to put a
plus passing loop in there so that any train movements does not affect what's running on the main line. It's that point there. So I'm going to have to move that point further down. Just about there where that signal is, and move the signal further back. At least another good 6 inches. And then hopefully it will join up just about here. So that point will probably stay where it is, but the track will come over more. There's enough space for the track to be about here. As long as I've got me 35mm, because that's what these centres are between the main line, 35mm. So yeah, so that's one of my bad areas, as it were, that needs to be looked at again. Now we move on to Tyne Dock, the first station to be completed here at the Northeastern. What I mean by completed, all the buildings, lights, everything. First station to be completed. And this is when I started thinking about scratch building, because I modified that kit. As you can see, it is quite narrow. I had chopped 15mm off either side to fit it onto this platform. And I also added a chimney which does not come with the kit. Metcalf kit underpasses, one that side and one this side. Now when you're fitting these on the platforms, you must allow a good 40mm gap between this end and that end, because those steps go down. You've got to imagine that there is an underpass under there, so they're not dead opposite each other. They need to be spaced out. Just thought I'd mention that. And here we have the other Metcalf kit. And this was the very first building that started putting details inside the rooms. To make them look more realistic. So yeah, in the early days it was all about building kits and modifying them, and Metcalf kits. Well, you can do that with Metcalf kits, just so easy to modify them. And there we have a Northeastern line side plate layers hut over there. That's an LC cut kit over there. There's quite a few of them on the layout now. I think I've got 4 of them on the layout. And there we have a Hornby signal box this time. All I've done there is just put an LED in it. At some point that will be coming off the layout. And I'll be adding a floor. As you can see, you've got a light on there, but there's nothing in it, and buildings don't look alive if there's nothing in them. Yeah, that's my thought on that. So there you go, that's Tyne Dock. Thank you. So we've done Tyne Dock Station. Let's look at the Tyne Dock Motorhome Depot while we're here. As you can see, that's a Backman building. It fits in quite nicely with this area. I think it holds two locomotives. I can't remember if I put lights in the building or not, but let's have a look as we pan round. Oh yeah, it looks like there is lights on in there. Yeah, so that's where the gas turbine locomotive's been hiding. Wonder where I put that. Yeah, this was a spur of the moment build. Like I said earlier on, it was just buy and plonk buildings. Not one single bit of scratch built here. Although the cobblestones look good still. I think the only thing I scratch built in this area is the pipework to those tanks. I think I did do a video on that some time back. And there's the office of the foreman. And the dog Badger there, see him just underneath the windowsill. Yet again, no detail inside the building. Yeah, hopefully we can do a video where we can just feature the diesels coming in and out of the depot. Yeah, that sounds like a good video to do, I think. As we pan the camera around, we come round to the 39 steps, which is more luck than judgment when I built these steps, which brings us from the lower level up to the upper level to South Shields. And here's Basildon Bond's car from the Green Menace story. There's Mrs. Sims. Taking a long time getting her fish and chips. And here we have South Shields Station. Station that took 18 months to build. There is a few secrets regarding this station. For those of you who followed the build and know what they are, the ceiling, if we go in there and look up, you'll find a magpie on the ceiling. And the other hidden secret is Mrs. Arkwright's brolly. Remember how she lost it? And it is still in the station. Now you're all telling me now, I can hear you all saying, ah, we know where it is, we know where it is. Yeah, it's in the telephone rooms. And the only way to get to it is to take the roof off and have a look inside the window, and you'll still see it in there, trapped in there forever. Well, this is a rare sight. I've just lifted off the main roof of the station just so we can have a look at all the finer details. Now, the champagne bottles are still there, look. That was left over from the grand opening of the station. Yeah, I've still got all the tops on. They haven't been touched. I'm surprised they're still there. As you can see, if we look closely in that corner of the window, they still see Mrs. Arkwright's umbrella.
And if you have a bump into it, just let her know where it is. And this roof comes off as well, so I'll just take this off so we can have a look at the newsagents and the barbers. So there's the newsagents, and there's the barbers over there with Pongo and Berry, the two dogs outside. So nothing changes. Once you've built something and you've finished, and it just gets left as it is. A little time capsule. And talking about cancer time capsule, I forgot to remove the bunting after the royal opening. And there you go, that's a blast from the past. And there's a view you don't see every day. It's weird without the roof on. Just thought I'd show you this side, where I've been placing some of the parcel boxes. Say about St Hilda's Colliery. Yeah, it was a bit of a mixed match as buildings go, but it does look like a colliery, with the main offices to the left there, with the plant room on the lower floor, and with the dispatch area for the coal. I do visit the colliery from time to time, adding extra details. The last time I added a little detail to the colliery was the weighbridge. Here. That was put in last year, I think it was. And all that is a thin piece of card scribed and painted and bronzy and then dirtied up, and yeah, so that was the last piece of detail I added to this colliery. There's many little interesting details on the colliery, mainly poor old Fred. He's been stuck up that chimney now for years painting the lettering on the side of the chimney there. So yeah, now that brings us nicely onto the home of the train spotters, which is High Shields, and there's the three lads there along with the gatekeeper, Jason, John and Joe, with Mr. Mo Edwards, who looks after the crossing. Here is where I actually started to get more interested in scratch building, with the pub conversion over in the corner there of the Railway Inn, which still looks as good as new when I first did the conversion. So yeah, the station itself is a really good close resemblance to High Shield Station as it was, even though it's a super quick kit. All I did was just added the little building on the left there. Yeah, it's like I said, this is where I started to do a lot of scratch building. The first building I scratch built was the vicarage, And that's just made out of Metcalf bits and pieces, and then with some stone brick paper. So yeah, that was purposely built to fit in that space. So that is High Shields. And that brings us nicely onto Little Haven, the station which is going to be loosely based on Westor. Obviously, the platform is not long enough to get all of that station in, but if I can focus on the main building and the building either side of the main building, I think that will be enough, because it's just quite a small station really. So yeah, this project will start once Jarrah Road is finished. So yeah, I did the platform at the same time that I did the platform for Jarrah Road. I thought I could kill two birds with one stone. And the last job I did here was adding the passing loop that the V3 is sitting on. And yeah, I've got some major plans ahead for Little Haven. And if I turn the camera to the left, we can see a pretty ugly side of the layout which hasn't been touched yet. I mean, it wouldn't take long to tidy that up. And so we can see more of it in future videos. Right, so if we just come round a little further, you can see that I'm heading towards Jarrah Road. Not forgetting the hidden pillbox. Yep, it's still there. So one last detail I want to show you before we move on to Jarrah Road for the latest update is this detail just in here, the pumping station along with the gasometer. Now the pumping station is a ratio kit and the gasometer is a gauge master's kit, so yeah, the only thing I scratch built there is that little bit of pipe work down there. I just thought I'd show you that. It very rarely gets seen. Anyway, so that's the layout. That's as it stands. You've seen the good bits and you've seen the bad bits. The bits that I want to change. Because a layout is always a progression. It's never finished. And if you're not happy with what you've got, you always got the opportunity to change it. And that's what I will be doing in a few areas. So let's have a quick look at Jarrah Road, where I've been working on for the last 4 or 5 months, and nothing's changed from last week. I've put a suburban train in there to get a rough estimation of heights for the balancing, which is going to run round the canopies here. So, and that's as far as we've got. So hopefully in the next video we can see a lot more progression on these canopies. And a lot of you asked, where am I going to go next once this station building's finished? Well, we have a signal box to go in here. So that's got to be built. And then we've got a cottage and a farm to go on that little area there. And then that should finish this part of the layout. There'll still be a back scene going in here, which will hide this banister whenever trains are going to go up Stevenson's Bank. So there's still plenty to do at Jar Road, but we're getting there. So you've seen the layout, I hope you've enjoyed what you have seen, especially the new subscribers who have recently joined us at the Northeastern, and there's been quite a few of you. There's been a couple of hundred over the last 2 months. So yeah, welcome aboard. And I think that's all from me. Until next time, stay safe everybody, and enjoy your model railways. Bye for now. Bye.